what's libertarianism? In a political sense, libertarianism is the application of natural law. Natural law is basically the universal legal principles which we humans are capable of recognizing naturally, through our reason alone, i.e. without any organization or government having to teach us all about it. Does natural law even exist? Well, certainly. It's a biological fact proven by the parts of our brain which make up what we would call our conscience. And of course we see that this basic non-aggression principle has been universally recognized across the globe and from the most ancient times. To understand this a little better, sail away with me to a little example. Robinson Crusoe awakes on a desert island and finds himself alone, and to make things interesting, he's lost all recollection of his past. Nevertheless, he's able to immediately recognize that he has control of his own body. He has self-ownership and free will, if you will. Given that he chooses to continue living, he sets about mixing his energy and creativity with the natural resources around him, and consequently he begins acquiring and producing his property. Thus we have property rights for one's own person and property. Now let's make things interesting and add another person to the equation. Along comes Friday, and as Crusoe has a natural right to himself and his property, it cannot reasonably also belong to Friday. If Friday were to attempt to claim it as his own, Crusoe would thus have the right to defend himself and his property from Friday. These acts would be a molestation of the natural rights of another, and would be contrary to all reason, conscience, and therefore nature. The only just interaction they can have with each other's property is either to trade or gift it to one another. So you agree with me so far? Well, let's apply these principles of natural law to modern ideas of government and see how they fare. Let's start with socialism. Most socialists are well-intentioned. Their hearts are in the right place. They see the poor and needy in unfortunate circumstances, and they rightly desire to alleviate any suffering. However, they posit a big government to seize the property of one section of the population by force or threat of force in order to distribute it to another. Clearly, this contradicts the natural law, and what's more, it removes any moral exchange which would occur between the individual. Through voluntary charity, the recipient feels a sense of gratitude for having been helped, and the donor feels moral satisfaction for having helped someone in need, perhaps believing that they in turn will help someone else in the future, spreading kindness in the world. Under socialism, however, when government swoops in and threatens the use of violence unless you cough up the cash, the citizen receiving the assistance develops a sense of privilege and makes demands over rights that do not naturally exist. Likewise, the citizen whose property has been seized is left with a sense of resentment. Instead, socialists typically view capitalism as the problem. The real problem is that what socialists call capitalism in the West today isn't capitalism at all. Rather, we see widespread corporatism, otherwise known as crony capitalism, or crapitalism for short. Crapitalism is where wealthy private interest groups either heavily lobby the government or simply buy the politicians outright, funding their tremendously expensive campaigns to office in return for favours afterwards. This is why we have businesses which are unnecessarily subsidised by government, and why some are too big to fail, and so are bailed out with taxpayers' money. Governments can thus be used by big businesses to stifle any competition from smaller businesses, and even go so far as to use tax-funded armies to protect and expand their business interests abroad too. Sound familiar? At the very least, this shouldn't sound like a free market system to anyone. Such a system ultimately results in monopolies being in cahoots with corrupt governments and inevitably fascism. This is the opposite of freedom and free markets, and certainly it's the opposite of capitalism. But isn't democracy the saviour and solution to every problem in the world? Well, no, it's not. Democracy is the problem which results in socialism and corporatism in the first place. Democracy is essentially a mob rule where 51% of the population can use government to violate the natural rights of the other 49%. Furthermore, these social democracies are the very foundation of corporatism. This is the reason for the fixed system of red versus blue, almost identical candidates whose policies only differ on how a tiny percentage of the vast national debt they have incurred is to be spent. Private interest groups have the system rigged in their favour, and the people are duped into thinking that they are free. A bit like a gambler who doesn't realise that whether he bets red or black, the house always wins. Democracy is freedom? Sure, freedom. For the sake of natural law, let's just take government out of the picture altogether. Only then do we see a system in which the natural rights to life, liberty and property can remain unmolested by others. The question of how we should live together in society is hugely important, and only libertarians advocate a system in which natural law is upheld without exception for every individual. Don't be fooled into thinking that this libertarianism could only work for Robinson Crusoe. As the great polymath Murray Rothbard wrote, "The regime of pure liberty, the libertarian society, may be described as a society where no man's property in his person or intangibles is molested, violated, or interfered with by anyone else. But this means that absolute freedom in the social sense can be enjoyed not only by an isolated Crusoe, but by every man in any society, no matter how complex or advanced. And of course, being in a society of voluntary exchanges, each man can enjoy absolute liberty, not in Crusoe-like isolation, but in a milieu of civilization, harmony, sociability, and enormously greater productivity through exchanges of property with his fellow men. Absolute freedom, then, need not be lost as the price we must pay for the advent of civilization. Men are born free and need never be in chains. Man may achieve liberty and abundance, freedom and civilization. But, I hear you say, without government, what will happen to the poor and needy? Who will stop fast food chains from killing my children? Surely there wouldn't be a justice system, so wouldn't everyone just kill each other with guns and swords and stuff? Who will stop climate change and pollution? Who will defend us from foreign armies? What about the terrorists and paedophiles and superbugs? Oh my! But most important of all, what will happen to the roads? All of these questions have been answered and will be in our next video. Government. Do we need it? To study the philosophy of liberty further, recommended reading would be The Ethics of Liberty by Murray Rothbard, which inspired this video. And please visit Mises.org, the excellent website for the von Mises Institute. Please like and subscribe for future videos like this, and get some conversation going in the comments section. Thank you.
Are you sick of government lackeys who say you didn't build that? Are you tired of elitists who think you need a government permission slip for everything? Everything you do is an A to B conversation, and the government should see their way out of it. Create true free markets by adopting the BIPCOT No Government License. The BIPCOT NoGov license allows use or modification of any product, service, or software except by governments or government agents. Go to BIPCOT.org. That's Bravo, India, Papa, Charlie, Oscar, Tango.org.
Hello, everybody, and welcome to Peaceful Anarchism on the Voluntary Virtues Network, on theseedsofliberty.com and theconsciousresistance.com. So today we have Rik Storey coming in from Turkey. He's a libertarian voluntarist and a father of a four-year-old girl, and he's a peaceful parent. He's the founder of That Libertarian Chap YouTube channel, and he's also got a Facebook page that he recently made, very recently. I'm actually the third person that liked it. I'm so honored. and then he's got his blog website called thatlibertarianchap.blogspot.com, and he writes for Proud Boy magazine as well, espousing the libertarian ideal. So that's wonderful. And you can also find him on Twitter at Rik Storey, R-I-K-S-T-O-R-E-Y, at Rik Storey on Twitter. And so we're going to talk a little bit about how he came to voluntarism and what his YouTube channel is all about, what he talks about, and his approach to peaceful parenting. And he interviewed a couple of really big names in the libertarian community, including Walter Block and Stephan Kinsella. So I'm sure they had a lot of wonderful, interesting things to say. So perhaps we'll talk a little bit about that. So, Rick, thanks a lot for coming on the show.
No, thank you for having me. It's a pleasure.
Yeah, no problem. I heard about you. I don't know. I think I remember under a thread, you posted one of your interview with Chase Rachels, also another awesome guy,
yes,
and author in the anarchist community. And you posted that, and I checked it out. And you know, even though I interviewed the guy as well, I love to hear him explain the concepts as well. And and it was great to see your channel, and I stumbled, you know, checked out your channel. I saw the Walter Block one, and I'm like, wow, this is really awesome. And you know, so you're a small channel, recently started. Well, not recently, but you're kind of a slow building it. And so I'm like,
yeah,
I want to, you know, help this guy, because we were all at that point, you know, at one time.
Yeah. Yeah. I was going to say, I really need to do a lot of work on my YouTube channel. I'm trying to get together a weekly breakdown of like news from a libertarian perspective. It's just slow going, but you've been very helpful. And actually, it was you who advised me to start the Facebook page. So that's kind of how useless I've been and how fantastic you have been. So thank you very much for that. And thank you for promoting everything now.
No problem. Yeah, yeah. So I assume that you were the first person to like it. Your wife was the second, so I'm the third. So, you know, that's a wonderful thing. You know?
Maybe. I'm going to have to check that. Yeah.
Yeah, you can definitely check that. But yeah, so I love, you know, I remember the enthusiasm I felt when I got my very first subscriber. I'm like, what? Somebody subscribed to my channel. Yeah, so cool.
Yeah. I mean, it's marginal utility from then on, isn't it? Subscribers you get.
Oh, right. Yeah.
Like 50. Yay.
Right, right.
Like 99.
Yeah. And yeah, I mean, so it's a wonderful thing, YouTube, for, you know, sending a message, and, you know, so many people use it, and especially Facebook. You know, I think something like 1.4 billion people use Facebook per day.
Yeah.
And so to not have a Facebook page to advertising your YouTube channel is just, you know, suicide for your, you know, for your content. So definitely, you know, you got to have that. And I think, you know, you put out some good content, and I think it's going to grow quickly. You just got to, you know, promote it. And, you know, you already write for the other, that magazine. So I think it's going to be quite easy to provide content. So please, get into a little bit about your history of, you know, how you came to voluntarism, what influenced you, you know, what authors and personalities or other YouTube channels, influenced you along the way.
Sure. Well, I was studying law back in England, and the interesting thing about libertarianism is, as Walter Block points out many times, libertarianism is actually a theory about law. That's fundamentally what it's about. We're talking about social norms. What is the rational way for us to be interacting with each other? That's what it's all about. That's what law is supposed to be about, maybe was once upon a time. And so when I was studying, there was this one guy in the class, and he was a bit of a loner, but I could see, you know, he was a nice guy, an intelligent guy. And I'm interested in strange characters, you know, unusual people. So I wanted to befriend him. I started talking to him. And he started talking to me, you know, very without any confidence about libertarianism. And I agreed with pretty much everything he had to say. I thought he was a fascinating person. And he introduced me to the word libertarianism, which I maybe had heard before, but just misunderstood it, didn't look into it much further. And so I pretty much became a libertarian. He insisted I check out Milton Friedman, and so I watched Freedom to Choose, the classic sort of economics TV series he did. And whilst Milton Friedman isn't as good as his son on the state and state coercion in terms of taxation,
right,
he's brilliant in terms of promoting free markets. He's got some good ideas there. And then I wanted to learn more. I wanted to immerse myself in this. And so I found a small book, which is pretty much about law, by Murray Rothbard, called The Ethics of Liberty. And really, that book was what blew my mind. It completely changed my thinking, had me asking questions I didn't even know could be asked. It really opened my mind to a lot of things. And so then I just became a voracious reader of these things alongside my legal studies. And it was so helpful for me to understand what was wrong with the law, with the legal system, with what we call positivism. So that's where the state claims to be able to make the law, and that makes it law. Studying how that came about, how, you know, medieval times kings wanted to expand their legal power in order to get revenue, basically. So that was how public law, basically state law, was created and sort of imposed on top of private law in Northern Europe. That the church said, well, the king has this this obligation to protect the king's peace and God's people and all this kind of stuff. And so he took advantage of it for obvious reasons. And so learning all of that history was so very important for me to become a voluntarist. And in fact, I do wish more libertarians would study legal history, because really that is studying libertarian history. When you're studying the history of law in Europe, and you find out that the foundations of all our law were built privately, and that private systems of government, as opposed to state systems of government, a judicial monopolist, a coercive force like that, they're not necessary. They're not a necessary evil at all. And they were not the foundations of Western law, which is supposed to be, you know, the law everyone wants to be a part of in the world, the system of law. So that was fundamental for me, I think.
Yeah, that's interesting. It reminds me of when people, you know, assert that, you know, without the state, there would be monopolies all over the place running rampant, you know.
Yeah.
McDonald's is gonna buy tanks and guns and force you to buy their McNuggets and, you know, all this kind of stuff.
Yeah.
And and I think it's helpful to dissect the word monopoly, because historically monopolies were only given by monarchs and by the kings, by the state.
It
was a state granted privilege of a monopoly.
Yes.
Right?
Yes.
Because really in the market, there is no such thing as a monopoly, because how could you coerce people or force them to buy your product when they can just buy another product if they don't like your product, if you're too expensive, if it's poor quality, if people, you know, it's like you're not only competing with people in your same genre or field, but you're also competing with other things that are completely unrelated that people could be spending their money on. So it's really such a myth, this idea of monopoly.
Exactly.
Go ahead.
I mean, it's just so simple. I mean, if I walked into Starbucks and every time I was being mugged at the door by the staff, I would go to Nero. Yeah. I don't like Nero as much, but I prefer it to mugging. It's really that simple.
Self-evident.
It's so self-evident, and you know, especially leftists, they bend over backwards to try and assert that free markets aren't really that good. They're like, well, who really needs a smartphone anyway? It's like most people in business today. It's just crazy, you know. It's unanswerable. It's all around us. It's overwhelmingly obvious to children.
You know, something like that. Who needs all these options, all this variety? You know,
yeah.
Why do you need to walk down the aisle in a grocery store and see, you know, 10 different things of this product and 20 different things of that product, and maybe to us who have lived in a Western industrialized country where, you know, the standard of living is much higher, you know, because of the wealth that has been produced, it doesn't matter that much to us. But for people that are less, you know, that do not live in such prosperity and wealth, that variety is paramount. It's essential.
Absolutely. Absolutely. It's the land of milk and honey.
Right.
You know, we can have sodas with like any flavor you can think of. Right. That's heaven, you know, for thousands of years. You know, that's like what people would imagine was heaven. You know, you can have anything you want, flavors, all these different sensations, whatever you want, anything you want. You got money, you can have it. That's heaven. That's what capitalism's offering.
Right.
It's not utopia. We're not offering you some kind of, you know, when Bernie Sanders was, you know, in the running, all these silly memes were coming out like, yeah, when Bernie Sanders is president, it's going to be like Star Trek. Everything's going to be amazing.
Really? You know, they said that?
Oh, yeah. There were so many memes like when Bernie Sanders is president and there's like spaceships flying around. So many times I saw this. Honestly, I'm telling you. But, you know, they just ignore reality. I mean, even if we did have Star Trek, people would be on the holodeck having orgies all day. Smoking like weed from the replicators and like Cheetos, replicators. That's what people would be doing all day. They wouldn't have this, you know, ambition to go out and be really productive or whatever, like Captain Picard. You know, they just wouldn't do that. There'd be no incentive. But you see, when you have the market, it's the invisible hand of Adam Smith. I want something from you, but I'm not looting you. I'm not plundering. I'm not doing anything bad. The interaction is entirely voluntary. And in providing a service, being a butcher, a baker, a candlestick maker, I'm providing a service to everyone in society. Now, if they have some money, they're doing something else. They can have whatever they want, whatever they want. Of course, it's not perfect because we do bad things.
Mm.
There are psychopaths and yeah, but most people are good. Most people, you walk down the road, they're not going to punch you in the face. But you know, it's capitalism that does that. It makes things as good as they're ever going to be, and it turns out that's pretty good, and people want it.
Right. Yeah. You know, the talking about the idea of variety being evil or options being evil. I remember I was listening to a podcast. This guy made a podcast called The Eastern Border. Young guy from Latvia, and. And it's a fascinating podcast because he talks about what life was like during the Soviet Union.
Yes.
Because, you know, we can learn about, you know, why it failed, you know, the calculation problem and all this kind of stuff. But
yes,
when you hear from the people that actually lived there what life was like, wow, it's fascinating. And one of the things he was saying was that, you know, some of the people were saying that they would find, like, somehow they would get a hand or, you know, they would get a one can of Coke or Pepsi and it was such a valuable thing, they would all share it equally, and then and then they saved the can. It's like wow. One can of Pepsi, you know. And it's kind of funny when people actually defend the Soviet Union, there are some people who long for it and defend it in the same way that I guess people who grew up in slavery, like chattel slavery, who know nothing of what actual freedom is like what is, you know, you can actually get paid for your work. Like, what is that? I don't even know what that is. So how can I even compare, right? So people who actually defend that kind of life, it's hard to talk to them because they can't even compare to anything else because that's all they've ever known, you know.
And it's
difficult because they're so emotionally wrapped up in it. And yeah, those are one of the more difficult people to talk about these things. But, you know, we try. We put out these podcasts, interview people. And, you know, I have definitely interviewed a good amount of people who have grown up in the Soviet Union and can attest to what has happened there, their experience and how horrible it was. And, you know, those are the people that resist that kind of, you know, oppression and totalitarianism, you know, and it doesn't, they're not easily supplicated and they don't become easily dominated. They, you know, their spirit is more rebellious and it's a wonderful thing.
Yeah. they're more individualistic and all the rest of it. Yeah. I met this guy from, oh my goodness, where is he from? I think he lived in East Berlin. His entire family had been killed by the Stasi, the secret police.
Right.
And he didn't have a good word to say about it. And not long afterwards, I went to Berlin to, just with a group of friends. We were passing through Europe. And there was the tour guide saying, and he was a massive lefty, and he was saying, you know, everyone was so happy. They had their car given to them, all this stuff. Oh, when capitalism came along, oh, all that stuff was taken away from them. And I just had to, tell him some of the stories that I remembered and said, it's just obvious to you that there were people who wanted to be free, mm-hmm. and there was no good reason they shouldn't be.
Mm.
Who on earth and from where do they get this right to stop people from just voluntarily doing what they want to do with their body? As these people were throwing themselves through barbed wire, machine guns, just to get out of that place.
Right.
How on earth can you say that everyone's happy? even if one person was not happy, the fact that you have a system that's going to murder them. It's like Joseph Stalin said. Joseph Stalin said, "People create problems. No people, no problems." And that was what it was like.
Oh my God!
If you can call a place like that happy, then God help you.
Right. So two things that I tell people like that is, well, if what you're seeking is like free food, free healthcare, free clothing, you know, no privacy, no private property, then prison is the perfect place for you. Right?
Yeah.
That's the first thing.
That's
the first thing. You know, actually, you know what? If you want a life like that, you're either a child, a hostage, a slave, you know, or a pet. One of those things.
Yeah. a pet. You're a farm animal.
Right, yeah.
You are.
Yeah, definitely. You are.
The first states, proper states, we had on this planet when, you know, still, most people were hunter-gatherers. So the first states that started popping up in the Middle East, probably, they were farming humans. That was what they were trying to do. It was nothing about helping people. It was nothing about national pride. It was about fooling people and forcing people into becoming cattle. Like the other animals that the first people were nomads who did this. So they were used to cattling all kinds of animals. And they thought, why are we just raiding people's camps for their stuff, their farms? You know, agriculture had come in by that stage.
Mm-hmm.
Why are we raiding it and getting a one-time payoff when we can just have these guys all around us farming? We build like a big tower. We build a religion up. I'll say I'm the sun god or something. And they just give me some of the food all the time. It's farming. There's no two ways about it. No two ways about it. And some people want to be sheep. Hey, if they want to, I can't stop them.
Right, you can't.
But they're trying to stop me.
Yeah.
So this is the problem. This is the problem ultimately. And so they, you know, you might think, oh well, we're past all that sun god stuff. We're not still superstitious, but we are. You were just saying people wanted to have free healthcare, free, you know, what would kids ask for if they could vote? Free video games or something, you know.
Right.
What you're saying is not free something. You're saying I want the state to put a gun to someone's head so that they can give them the money to go and get that for me.
Mm-hmm.
The belief that the state can somehow just go around doing this, whereas you would never expect that from a civilian, is purely religious. It's pure superstition to believe that there's this real entity, the corporate state. And so long as people are working in the office of states, you know, some state office, they can do all sorts of things which would break private law. You know, you could sue them, you could get damages from this person. But no, if they're in the office of a state, they can do it and no one can say anything. Because public law, it's pure religion. So it's still strong, and it is farming. You're absolutely right.
Yeah. Like, it's hard to talk because I'm a homeschooling father, and I hang out with a bunch of homeschooling families, and some of them come from communism, and some of them say, well, you know, in communism things were much better because, you know, they give you a car, they give you an apartment, they give you all this stuff, food, and it's just wonderful, and it's all free, and you don't pay any taxes, and, you know, that's, you know, they're saying that's the epitome of humanity. That's where we reached our peak. When the Soviet Union fell, we've been declining ever since. Because now you got to pay for everything. It's so ironic, yeah. Because it's like when the state controls everything, you know, the market is completely enslaved. How do you determine prices? Yeah. How do you determine the rational allocation of resources?
Right.
You know, how do you know where to put anything? You know, and the state has no idea. Yeah. Massive amounts of waste, massive dependence on black markets. You know, these people without the black market, like without getting the things that they needed from the West that was much more free, they would have perished long ago. And it's kind of funny that they attribute all of that to the state.
Yeah. Yeah, exactly. Oh, my goodness. Oh, there's so much to say, isn't there? I mean, whenever you have property in common, that's a bad idea. You know, put the children's favorite flavor of pizza in the middle of the table, suddenly open it. They're all going to scramble for pieces to put on their plate. They might not need it right then.
Right, yeah.
They'll choke themselves if they eat all that. They're just grabbing it for later.
Right.
You know, this is how the buffalo went extinct in America, where you're at. You know, the buffalo were given to everyone by the Sky Father.
Right.
So they didn't belong to anyone. And, you know, so the white guy comes along with a better way of hunting them. And the process at which they were becoming extinct, because they were, horses had already gone extinct.
Mm-hmm.
Just increase exponentially. Whereas the cow, being farmed privately, owned privately, is doing pretty well. There's a fair few, you know, few of them around.
Right.
It's just so obvious. It's just obvious. Owning property in common is just absurd. And it's the big lie of Marxism and all the different subgroups, you know, that's still strong, still with us, that private property is a bit of a bad thing. It was always a bad idea, and we've got to try and control it somehow. That's not the bad thing, and the class war is not between blue collar and white collar. That's not where the fight is. The fight is, again, the real class war is against the political class. It's against this group who thinks that they can break laws, objective laws that we all know. Don't kill me. How do we know that? Well, you know, I don't want to be killed. And if I go around killing other people, I'm basically saying that's okay.
Mm-hmm.
You know, but there's this group who claims to be able to break laws with impunity, this political class. And they're screwing all of us over, especially the middle class, because they're the greatest producers.
Mm-hmm.
So they can get more money from them and say, hey, working class, you want some of this? Then vote for me.
Right.
You know, this is a terrible game. But you see, that's where the class war is really at. So I really feel for leftists sometimes, because their heart is often in the right place. But they are just religiously devoted to this belief that private property is the problem. Capitalism, it seems such a nasty word. It's like saying Satan to a Christian. Hey, Satan's not so bad. Ah, you know, they're not going to listen to you after that. You know, the shutters are right down. What can you do? Keep trying.
Actually, you just remind me of a meme where it says, you know, when people say, you know, if you want to change society, you have to go into politics and, you know, Change it from the inside. Become a governor, become a mayor. And then people, someone put a meme like, if you want to change hell, go to hell. Change it from the inside. So please talk about your channel, That Libertarian Chap, why you made it, and what do you talk about, and perhaps go into a little bit about your conversation with Walter Block and Stephan Kinsella.
I mean, I created YouTube channel before, which became fairly successful. But in terms of libertarianism, I didn't set out to do that. I just wanted to, well, I haven't done that yet, obviously, but it's not that popular. But I just wanted to create one video just kind of outlining what libertarianism is in as basic as a way as I could. Basically, voluntaryism. That's where I was going. Anarcho-capitalism, is my brand of libertarianism. And So I set out to do that. I wanted to kind of make a really, really, really short version of The Ethics of Liberty by Rothbard. And so I put a little Robinson Crusoe illustration in there to show the interactions between these two people and how they handle the property that they've acquired and how we all just know it's not right to use violence, aggression, coercion, against each other. That's it's not a sustainable form of behavior. But more than that, if we're going to develop any sort of social norms, ethics, whatever, law, basically, we need to look at what kind of behaviors are universally applicable to everyone, and they're unconditional. And that's basically this negative right to be left alone. And that's it. That's the only thing that's pretty much, universally applicable. It's unconditional. Mm-hmm. All the positive rights, and that's all bound up with a state positive law. Mm-hmm. So they can create a law to say you have a right to free speech. That's not universally applicable, because then, you can't have that in the library, you can't have that in the cinema, it's conditional. So you don't really have that right. We have a right to healthcare. Well, can you force a doctor at gunpoint to help someone? Maybe not. So you see, all the time you're positing law, you're putting forward these rights, or you've got a right to bananas, you're basically just trying to come up with an excuse. You're calling it a law. You're calling it a right. But really what it is a breach of people's negative rights. So I just want to try and get that across to people. And that's basically what I try and get across on my YouTube channel all the time. And I started interviewing Stephan Kinsella, because obviously he's from a legal background. I tried bouncing some ideas off him by email, some of these ideas. And he said, just talk to me on Skype. This will be much easier. I said, can I record it? He said, yeah, sure. Put it on my YouTube channel. Started emailing some other people with interesting ideas. And that's just what I'm doing all the time. Tried doing a few other things, like what I love and hate about Marxism, what I love and hate about conservatism, what I love and hate about democracy, and a few videos like that. And trying to do my weekly breakdown of the news. But really, it's just all about promoting voluntarism and also Western civilization. I'm really pro the West. I think everyone should be really pro their society. I live here in Turkey, and people are really pro being Turkish. I mean, like, in a kind of ethnic sense. They kind of just celebrate their silly quirks and their silly, kind of sense of humor and all kinds of things like this. They're just happy to be themselves and that kind of thing. And they take what's good and they say, this is what's really good about the culture in my society. I want my grandkids to have this too. I'm pro-Western civilization because this, in the West, especially the Anglosphere, that's where libertarianism really manifested. I mean, it didn't come on so strongly anywhere else. And so I think, whatever is good about Western civilization, I mean, because there's been some bad, everyone knows there's been some bad, you know, that's worth celebrating, that's worth holding on to, that's worth teaching to our kids. And yeah, like I say, just celebrating and wanting to try and preserve for future generations. And so I try to do that as well on my YouTube channel, try to look up the history of libertarianism, the history of law in the West as well. So that's what it's all about. Primarily, I want my audience to be in the UK as well. That's, you know, where my heart is, converting Brits to libertarianism.
Nice. Yeah, you know, when I think of Walter Block, I think of him as the Mozart of Austrian economics, because and libertarianism, I guess, because he's so incredibly prolific. Like, he's written so many books, he's written so many articles, he's probably got like the record of like the most amount of, was it peer-reviewed articles in a like a journals, you know, and he's thousands, he's gonna write more, he's gonna write more books. And oh my god, I read like half of his book, the and I just love the guy, because you know, even though that book is like written in the '80s, I think, but I think I think he did such a great job of basically defending free trade and, you know, all of these professions that we consider to be evil and immoral and wicked are basically just voluntary interactions.
Yes,
you know, like what is like a prostitute, like like pimps, and
blackmailer,
and the slum lord, and the ticket scalper, I think. All these different people that most people hate, and I love bringing that book up and just naming those people, because immediately when you name those kind of people, you see the kind of visceral agitation that it incites in people immediately, you know?
Absolutely. But you see, that's people think we libertarians, we're trying to set out some almighty ethic to impose on everyone.
Mm-hmm.
It's just not it at all. You know, like I was saying, Walter Block, he says it again and again. This is a theory of law. We're talking about law, and law is different to morality, okay? Because if someone cheats on someone, a husband cheats on his wife, he's a philanderer, yeah?
Mm-hmm.
We say, ooh, I don't like that guy. But has he broken a law? Can we say that he's broken a law? No, it's an immoral thing that he's done, but it's not necessarily breaking a law. I mean, if there's a contract involved, well, you know, have to read the contract, see what that says.
Right.
So you've got to distinguish between law and morality. And as soon as you do that and you say, you know, libertarianism, we're talking about law here. I find that helps to kind of calm people down a little bit, because otherwise, you know, they start thinking we're happy with children being forced to work in mines or something like that because of their circumstances. They're forced to. It's like, no, you've got it all wrong. I think it's better for a child to go and work in a sweatshop than to be a prostitute. So now we're talking about morality, okay? But in terms of law, can you force the child to stop working in the sweatshop? Can you or should you? Because you know they're probably going to end up as a prostitute
mm-hmm.
if you do that.
Mm-hmm.
Okay? So it's really important we get that law bit right, and then we can start talking about what's moral. It's important to separate these two as libertarians.
That's very interesting that you say that, because you know, I often tell people, yeah, legality and morality are diametrically opposed, right? So when I say that, I'm referring to state arbitrary man-made law, right? As opposed to I guess
what private court
polycentric legal system. Yeah. I think that's what you're referring to when you say law. So I think when you say that, like, if I were to tell people that, that would confuse them. So I'm more, for me, my style is more focusing on morality. I guess because you come from a legal background, so maybe you have more of an ease of talking about it from that perspective.
You're right. I've got to define my terms. You're absolutely right. When I talk about law, I'm not talking about what's legal, as in legislated.
Yeah, exactly.
I'm not talking about state legislation.
Right.
I'm talking about what we can determine are, you know, social norms,
right,
for determining what is reasonable human behavior, what's reasonable interaction between two merchants. And like I say, it's important for libertarians to know their Western legal history, because all the foundation of Western law was developed by private courts.
Mm.
It was developed outside of the state. It was not state law. It wasn't kings saying this stuff.
Mm-hmm.
It was private judges employed by private individuals, you know, all of merchant law. And that's still hugely important for international law, which is kind of anarchic because you don't have some super state, global state, telling the states what to do. And commercial law, that came from merchant law. That was private courts right the way from England all the way down to Italy. You could be a merchant, go into a different country, go into a city, and you could expect to get the same kind of law and treatment there as you could pretty much anywhere else, because they were private courts. And it was pretty easy to determine what's fair, what is fair exchange. And if you didn't like that one, you go to someone else. So the competition made the law really good, made the decisions really good. That's why they've stood the test of time. And states are still having to use them. They're still deferring to them because it's good. And that was all developed privately. So you're absolutely right. I need to define my terms. When I say law, I'm really talking about private law, private courts. You know, even when I say government, I don't mean state. I could be talking about a private system of government,
right?
That someone has privately employed, you know, to be their legal system and to be their whatever. Mm. Not a state system of government, which is forcing itself upon you to accept its services and forcing you to pay for them. There's state legislation, there's law, which is a completely different thing, and then morality, which is our cultural foibles and you know, what we find taboo.
That's definitely a big distinction that I'm often drawing to people. For example, in your example of the you know, with the man cheating on his wife. Yeah, that's the question I would ask first is, was there a contract?
Yeah.
Was there a contract? And and if there wasn't a contract, let's just say they were together, you know, boyfriend. It doesn't have to be a contract with the state. It can just be a contract between them, private contract, right? Or with their religion or whatever. And if there was no contract, if they just got together and they, like, you're my boyfriend, you're my girlfriend, and one guy cheats, you don't really have a case to make at all. Because, right, what are you going to say? What are you going to do? You can't do anything.
Yeah.
So
he slept with you. He's sleeping with someone else.
Yeah.
It's his sexual organ.
Exactly. So one thing you said was very good. I like is you know, we have to. It's very important to define our terms, because I think that's where a lot of people encounter confusion. And they talk past each other. You know, we talk about these terms like law, like morality, like capitalism, government, state. And like you said, government could be self-government. Like I govern myself.
Precise. Know? Yeah. You know? Right. Exactly. Yeah. It just means like a rule.
Yeah.
Something that's ordering something, you know.
Right. And I think it's
something that's giving something an order. Yeah.
I think it's Stephan Kinsella that he makes a distinction that, you know, when as libertarians, anarchists, and volunteers, as we talk about these things, instead of saying government, we should say state, the state. It's a more accurate
and he's
term.
Right. I think he's right.
Yeah.
Because, well, as well, if you use the term anarchist, not only are people going to think you're referring to anarcho-communists, so the kind of anarchism you had in Spain in the early 20th century.
Right.
Because that's what anarchist meant back then. It had a very specific meaning there.
Right.
they're also going to think that you're meaning an absence of law and order.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, exactly.
Which, of course, can and was handled privately.
Right.
In Europe.
Yeah. So you know, when I talk about these things, I tend to avoid like saying first the terms like I'm an anarchist or like people I tell them I have a website and a podcast and they say what's the name, and I don't want to tell them the name first. I basically come at it from a different angle. So basically, I say I'm what's called a voluntarist, and you know what voluntarism is. Most of them say no, and you say, well, we advocate for voluntary interactions between peaceful people. That's it, right? And
yes.
And do you support that? I'm like, of course I do. Yeah. Who wouldn't support that?
Exactly.
You know?
Exactly.
And then, go ahead.
Well, I was going to say, I was having this conversation recently with Matthias von Gutenberg, who is an American. He is the editor of A Spontaneous Order by Christopher Chase Rachel.
Oh, cool. Nice.
And lovely guy, very intelligent guy. And he said, exactly what you're saying is the best way of doing it. Say I'm a libertarian, and then to get the other person kind of on the back foot, because they're thinking, what do I believe that is then going to be infringing upon this person's liberty?
Mm-hmm.
Because I think a lot of the time, I mean, say you were talking to a leftist, they're going to be like, in your face. Yeah. How can I show that this guy is a bigot? Or something. I'm going to find out what's so bigoted about him. As soon as you say, yeah, I'm a libertarian. Yeah, I believe all interactions should be voluntary. you know, I think we should be really peaceful. Right. They're sort of, yeah, me talking about free healthcare, that's kind of violating his private property rights. Makes them uncomfortable because they know, oh, okay, yeah, that's good, what he's talking about. I have to squirm and try and think of some reasons why I'm actually good. I'm so used to being good all the time. I'm virtue sick all over the place. So that's a really good technique, yeah.
Yeah, so basically it's the difference between saying what we're against and saying what we're for. Right.
Yes.
So we're not only anti-state and anti, you know, legislation,
right.
Anti-regulation, anti all the coercion, but we're for peace, for freedom, for, you know, peaceful parenting, for, you know, voluntary interaction. And it's important to delineate that. Right. And explain that. So please, can you get into a little bit about your approach to peaceful parenting? Because you have a daughter of four.
I also have a son of one.
Oh, you do. Great. Wonderful.
Okay, so my background is I'm an educator. I know a lot about early years and early years psychology. And I have not read a huge amount about peaceful parenting. Very interested in the ideas. Really, I just try and apply my libertarianism to my child. I try and talk to her about it all the time. To the extent that she will say things to me now like, stop telling me what to do. You have your brain. I have my brain. She says, and I was like, ugh.
She got me. She got me.
Yeah, you're right. Yeah. But it's difficult. You know, as parents, it's very hard. You have to know your child very well.
Yeah.
You have to know when to draw the line as the guardian, because you accept this person has not reached the age of reason completely.
Mm-hmm.
And so they're going to harm themselves, and technically they'd be able to later say, when, you know, they are able to make a rational thought process out of it, they will be able to say, why didn't you do anything?
Mm-hmm.
And yeah, you'd be in the wrong.
Mm-hmm.
So it's very tough. Parenting is hard, you know, even if you're a libertarian, especially if you're a libertarian.
Mm-hmm.
Because we want to help the children to grow, to be independent, think independently. We need to be a source of authority sometimes. But drawing the line as to whether it's coercion or not, that's hard. But violence towards a child, I think we may have all seen it. Certainly I've seen it in England. You're on the train. The child is hardly doing anything. I mean, you don't know what's happened for the rest of the day. So it can be hard to judge, you know, too quickly. But for the parent to just start swearing and being physically violent with the child when at that point in time they're not doing anything, you're damaging them psychologically. You're going to turn them into a very aggressive person. They're not going to be able to handle aggression from other people properly. They're not going to be able to handle any sort of emotional situation properly. They're not going to be able to handle it rationally, coolly. That part of their brain will remain very inactive. The emotional side of their brain will kick in. All the stuff to do with testosterone is going to kick in, and you're no longer going to be dealing with a rational human being. So, you know, if you want to raise your child to be that, by all means, you know, hit them and strike them when they've hardly done anything. But if you want your child to be an intelligent, rational person who understands the most appropriate thing to do in social situations, well, stop hitting them, start talking to them, start making deals with them, start negotiating with them, and know where to draw the line. Of course, if your child is being violent to another child, you know, you need to intercept. If your child is going to hurt themselves, you need to intercept. One thing I will say, though, is I'm all about proportional punishment. I mean, as a libertarian. And so my extension of libertarianism to my child is, if they've done something, they need to understand that they've lost any right to say, well, that should never happen to me. If they think it's acceptable to other people, then they need to understand people are going to be doing that to you if you do that.
Right.
And sometimes that's as simple as seeing my daughter push another child and letting her get pushed back, you know? Sometimes it's as simple as that.
Yeah.
And then explain to her afterwards why she got pushed back and why she has no grounds to complain about it, you know?
Right. Yeah, you know, it's, you're completely right. I agree that parenting is even more difficult. I would say it's even more difficult for libertarians and voluntarists because, you know, we're actually trying to, you know, get to know your, you know, our children and understand the way they think. And, you know, although they do not reason now, we want them to reason, therefore we should reason with them, right?
Yes, exactly.
So that's not a reason, that's not a point for not reasoning with them, you know? So we do want them to get to that point. And so, you know, they will emulate our actions and our behavior. So, you know, therefore we should reason with them all the more. And it's difficult because, you know, like you said, like it's more, you know, the way I look at peaceful parenting is we're evening the playing field. You know, we are natural authority figures, like in the sense that we're older, bigger, stronger, naturally, you know, just inherently, and have more experience. But and so my approach to parenting is lessening that power differential as much as possible, because the last thing, I mean, basically, you know, people who use and assert their parent status and, you know, get angry or hit, it's the same way as a bully on a playground, you know, who's bigger and stronger than other kids, just pushing and hitting because they're bigger and stronger, right? So that's not a sign of any achievement. It's basically a sign of cowardice, you know, that you you're only asserting your dominance because you're bigger and more powerful. And that doesn't teach anything. And like you said, it encourages aggression. Yeah. It encourages the use of violence to solve their problems. Yeah. And you know, we have to think of what kind of message are we sending to our kids by our behavior, right?
Yeah.
So we cannot be hypocrites in the
way
we raise.
I mean, we can all get angry. I mean, we're not perfect just because we're libertarians. You know, a lot of us are nice guys.
Right.
You know, we can all lose our temper.
Right.
But I mean, even then, if you do, you know, talking to your child and saying sorry.
Yeah.
Right. Now, I've had to apologize to my child about my behavior.
Mm.
And that's good because, out there in the world, you know, might equals right a lot of the time. You know, this is a cruel universe we live in, really.
Mm-hmm.
And it's very hard for us to deal with. let alone explain to our children, who get to that age, they start talking about death, they start fearing death.
Yeah.
And so then, you know, when it comes time to teaching them about this cruel universe, we've got to teach them to think beyond that animalistic might equals right mentality. It takes effort and it takes a lot of self-reflection on our part to then teach the child how to be self-reflective themselves and how to come to terms with things they've done and what to do about social situations in the future and difficult circumstances and dealing with disagreements and, you know, especially conflict over property, you know, that, no, that's mine, that's mine, that's mine. And right. You see that libertarianism, when we're teaching that to our children, that expands out into society, that goes out into all of society. If all the children are being taught might equals right, then when the state comes along and says, yeah, well, I'm the mightiest, so do what I say, mm-hmm. they're like, well, okay, yeah, I guess I'm better, you know. Whereas if you're saying, no, question the authority,
mm-hmm.
question the authority. No, you're in control. You're in control of your body. Your leg, that's not someone else's leg. That's your leg. You can't come and say, this is your leg. It's not. My daughter thinks that's really funny. but then she uses it against me later, you know.
That's great.
So, you know, she'll say, I have my brain, you have your brain. Leave me alone, she'll say. I'm kind of really proud of her, but, you know, I also want to try and think of something, you know, witty comeback.
Comeback,
yeah. So that's what it's about. So if you have people thinking like that in society, they'll question the authority of the state. They'll be far more individualistic in their outlook on society. And that's, I mean, I think that makes a healthier society at large. That's what I value. I said I value Western civilization. It's those principles, it's those thinkers and those ideas, that competition of thought that's made Western civilization what it is. And, you know, I see it as, you know, preserving the West and my culture in a way, what I value about the culture that I've grown up in, by teaching those libertarian principles to my child. See, I was doing my bit.
Beautiful. Beautiful, yeah. And I'll say one thing before we wrap up, which is cool. When people ask me how do I parent or how should I, or how, you know, they're saying, how should I parent? Say, well, however you want to see the future, what kind of world do you want your children to live in? That's the way you parent.
Exactly.
That's the way you parent your children.
I love that.
You know, your children, the children of this generation will create the world of tomorrow.
Right.
And it's up to the parents to decide what that world would be, you know? So it's really, really incumbent upon parents. They have the greatest job in the world in that they're creating the world of tomorrow. So I applaud anybody who's raising their children peacefully, morally, compassionately, gently, all that kind of stuff. So thank you for that.
No, thank you. That was really good. And I apologize to your viewers as well, but I'm losing light in here.
No problem.
I didn't want to give you difficulty editing by standing up to go and turn on the light. So hope it's okay.
Yeah,
you can
no
still
problem.
Hear me. So
no problem. So before we go, please reiterate your, you know, the ways that people can reach you if they want to follow your work.
Yeah, my YouTube channel is That Libertarian Chap, and I'm also a columnist at Proud Boy magazine. So Google those and you'll be able to find my blog, my YouTube channel, and on Facebook as well. Danilo helped me create a Facebook page. So please like it.
Yes.
You might even be the fourth like. Imagine that.
If you're lucky.
I won't look past you. I will value that. I'll remember you.
Excellent. Please follow his channel. Really awesome channel. It's growing, and you know, we need all support we can get to get these messages of freedom, voluntarism, and free markets out there. There's not enough content creators. You know, we could always use more. So I value each and every one of you who are content creators spreading this message. It's a beautiful thing. So, you know, I'm hoping I'm going to give your page a little boost with this interview. So that's my hope.
Thanks a lot, buddy.
No problem.
Really good to talk to you. You're
no
a cool
problem.
Guy.
Yeah, thank you. So actually, another thing before we go, I usually ask my guests, what is your favorite quote of all time?
My daughter wanted to go to the cinema. to watch a film, but the age was too high for her. She's saying, well, why won't the cinema let me in? I said, well, darling, the queen says you're not allowed to go. Okay, I was trying to, you know, break it down for her. And she was only like 3. Uh-huh. And she said, the queen won't let me go in the cinema, but that means the queen is bad. We should put the queen in the dungeon, she said. We should put the queen in the dungeon.
Okay. Huh. All right. So, understanding that nobody has a right to her decisions, I guess, or nobody has a higher claim on her body. not even the queen.
Exactly. And not even the queen.
Awesome. That's
Can
great.
You imagine?
Beautiful. I love it. self-ownership, recognition of self-ownership at the age of 3.
From a 3-year-old.
Exactly. See that? See, these principles are so self-evident, you know, by the simple phrases of, you said so, I had it first, it's mine, these kind of simple phrases, I think illustrate property rights, contractual obligations, self-ownership, right? All the stuff that we as volunteers talk about. So wonderful, beautiful quote. So if anybody, thank you very much, Rick, for coming on the show. I really appreciate it. Magnificent conversation. So if anybody wants to help me out, you can do so through the links below. Help me out through Patreon, Bitcoin, or PayPal. Links are below. That's patreon.com/peacefulanarchism to help me out. $1 a show is all I ask. I love interviewing wonderful people like Rick here, and I want to do more of it. And monetary compensation is always encouraged and appreciated, right? We are capitalists in the end. We respond to incentives. I provide all this stuff for free, but, as we know, there is always opportunity cost to every decision we make. So if I'm not doing this, if I'm doing this, I'm not doing another thing, right? So there's always an opportunity cost. But thank you very much, Rick. Really appreciate it. So this is Peaceful Anarchism on the Voluntary Virtues Network. And theseedsofliberty.com and theconsciousresistance.com. Wishing all of you have a wonderful day. Take care. Bye.
Cell 411 is a free app for Android and iOS that replaces government-controlled 911. Cell 411 allows you to preset a group of friends or private organizations to show up in any emergency. Cell 411 is a nightmare for the state because it proves their so-called services aren't needed. Cell 411 has had thousands of installs, and of course it's covered by the BIPCOT no government license. Cell 411 because your friends won't shoot you when you're in trouble. Without the government, who would build the emergency services? You and Cell 411. Get it today at getcell411.com. That's getcell411.com.